I'm internalizing that I'm not strong. And as someone growing up in a world of strong Black women, it's kind of like, well, if I'm not strong, then what am I? Mm-hmm. Like, am I going to be the quote welfare queen? Like, what other stereotype am I going to fall into if mm-hmm. I'm not being the Black strong Black woman? Because the strong Black woman and like Black excellence are like mm-hmm. the gold standard stereotype for Black women.
Repeat after me. I bring more than diversity. I bring irreplaceable perspectives. Hey friends, my name is Whitney and I'm the host of Impostrix podcast, the show that validates professionals of color navigating imposter syndrome and racial toxicity in their career. Join us and be validated. You got this.
Welcome back to Impostrix podcast. I'm Whitney Knox Lee, your host, and I'm joined today with Julia Washington, who does a lot, an artist, a podcaster. And I am new to her podcasts. I'll tell you why after she introduces herself. Well, I'll tell you why now, because I don't do pop culture. Like, I don't do pop culture. I'm always the one removed from the situation. My friends are always like, okay, Black card revoked for Whitney. like, I just don't know the stuff. And so Julia podcasts around pop culture and representation of folks of color in media, and queer folks as well, too, right? Is mm-hmm. that part? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
And so, yes, Julia, please introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Julia Washington. I host Pop Culture Makes Me Jealous, where we analyze pop culture through the lens of race or gender, and sometimes both. And then we have a sister show, Jelly Pop's Book Club, where we read book-to-screen adaptations, and we really get into whether or not the adaptation holds up, what they're missing, what they're, you know, if it's good, whatever, what have you. And it's been a lot of fun. I've learned a lot about myself going through this process. But yeah, those are my babies. I mean, not obviously my real baby, but like, you know, my creative babies. My child knows. He knows where he stands. Yeah.
Okay. So I invited Julia on the show because I'm really interested in talking about how folks of color are portrayed and represented in media, what stereotypes these portrayals advance. And also where, you know, what media is really doing its job to reconstruct the narrative around some of these stereotypes. And so two of the stereotypes that we're going to talk about today are the strong Black woman stereotype and the angry Black woman stereotype. And the reason is when Julia and I were having our pre-podcast conversation, we talked about the through line between how media has developed over time to include in different ways people of color, and to take into consideration in different ways audiences of color, but also to include storytellers of color. So there's been a lot of change and transition in terms of how stories are told, and how they include us and how they portray us. And one of the shows that we got to talking about was Harlem, because the through line was Girlfriends, Insecure, Harlem. Mm-hmm. And I was nodding along, like I'd seen the whole thing, had not. So went back, started watching some of Harlem. And the episode that I left off on, I was actually binging on it last night. The episode that I left off on was the episode on strong Black women in season one. And I immediately emailed Julia and was like, okay, we need to talk about this, because so much is coming up for me with that. Mm-hmm. So, but before we get into that, first, I want to ask you, Julia, what identities are you bringing into this space?
So I am biracial. I am one of those biracial people who it is their identity, because when you don't look like your parents, but you look exactly like your parents, it is hard to not have it shape how you see the world. My dad's Black, my mom's Italian, and so the clashing of the cultures actually merged really well, but then also sometimes not. Mm-hmm. And so that's a huge part of my development in my existence and understanding how I fit in the world, how I don't fit in the world. And I'm also a single parent. My child is, I can't even say it. He's going to be 20 this year. So hard to say out loud.
No way. Y'all, yeah. If you're watching this, you know that Julia does not look like she can have a 20-year-old. Wow.
I know. I keep aging myself.
And so he's an adult.
He's an adult. Yeah, he's gonna participate in his first presidential election, and he's at university, and you better believe I'm going driving his ballot down there for us to go through it line by line together. Like, oh, you can't come home? That's fine. I'll bring it to you. This is important. but that, you know, I became a mom really young too. So like, you know, in the process of like understanding my own racial identity, I become a parent, and then it turns into, I have this child who looks like a replica of me, which is the first time in my life having that experience. So it was just, it's really interesting experience. So that's kind of how I got into really doing, the dive into understanding the representation that we're given and what that means for us, because I've never had anything on TV that felt, well, that's not entirely true. There are elements of TV shows that you do kind of relate to, and you're like, oh, that reminds me of this family, you know, all these things. But in terms of like my experience as a biracial Black woman, have not seen it on television, but have definitely experienced some of the stereotypes placed on me that I didn't ask for.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Wow. And what is the racial identity of your son? Do you know what half?
Yeah. Yeah, his dad is Irish, and that was a cultural wake up call for me. 20 years of getting used to Irish family.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. This reminds me of a story.
White. They're like, we're Irish. I'm like, yeah, but also you're white. Like, you move through the world as white people. Like, no one's confused that those are your parents.
I went to Ireland when I was younger. I love Ireland, and found myself some Irish boyfriends. And yeah, Ireland's great. Irish people are great. So, okay, cool. Awesome. All right. So that's how we're coming to these conversations, because perspective matters. Like, our perspective mm-hmm. on how we're receiving this information from media matters. So can you talk to us just a little bit about where we've come as far as media and the representation of people of color and Black women?
I would say that nowadays we definitely have more voice and space in writers' rooms. In terms of like executive level, decisions are still primarily, or boardrooms are still primarily white and male. We have had this interesting, strange phenomenon that's happening not just in media, but in general, where in 2020, everyone was like, we've got to do better. And then promises were made. And then this year, we're seeing promises revoked. And what's interesting is that in what I feel is the most the best time for television was the late 90s, early 2000s, when we had UPN, before UPN merged with the W. And that's when we got a lot of like network Black television that had staff who were Black writing the stories.
What's UPN? And,
it's United Paramount Network, I think is what it stands for. Okay. It was a network television. So if you didn't have cable, you had access to it. If you had an antenna, you had access to it. It was not a premium channel. And between Fox and UPN, we saw a lot of Black content coming out. You know, Fox had Martin, Living Single, in living color, which, you know, predates a lot of the stuff that UPN did, because UPN didn't really establish until 1995. But in 2006, it merged with the WB and became the CW. And what we saw happen in that merger is that every single UPN show that was Black, with the exception of Everybody Hates Chris and Girlfriends, was canceled.
Wow.
That's in 2006.
Where was I in 2006? I had just graduated high school.
Yeah. So with few exception, I did find, because I was like, I'm pretty confident that's accurate, but I did find that there was a TV show, The Game, which I did not watch, that started in 2006. After the merger, and that was interesting, but you take a network that has a primarily Black audience, mm-hmm. merge with a network that is youth driven, and remove all of the Black content minus Girlfriends and Everybody Hates Chris. And then my question always is, well, if Chris Rock wasn't attached to that show, would it have survived? Who knows? We'll never know the answer. We can make an assumption.
Yeah.
And then Girlfriends didn't really survive much after that. I think it was canceled in 2008 after that. And then from there, we didn't really have any female-driven, all-female-led casts until we get to Insecure in 2016, so nearly a decade. Wow. Mm-hmm. And that's on HBO, which is a premium channel. So mm-hmm. if you don't pay for the premium channel, you don't have access to Insecure. In between that time frame, you have the ABC developing Scandal with Shondra Land, say it five mm-hmm. times fast, mm-hmm. Which, you know, Kerry Washington leads. It is a diverse cast, but it's still not necessarily like a Black show, right? So then 2 years later in 2014, we get Blackish, which was developed by Kenya Burris and starring Anthony Anderson and Tracee Ellis Ross and a whole host of amazing actors, Lawrence Fishburne, Jennifer Lewis. Like mm-hmm. we've got this amazing cast of characters, and that runs for a number of seasons. But there's still like tension behind the scenes because eventually Kenya Burris leaves because of conflicts between, you know, him and the network and how they wanted to address certain things on the show, because the show is pretty much, you know, here's what it's like to be sort of Black in America and also Black in America, because they really do lean into Tracee Ellis Ross's biracialness.
Yeah.
Which mm-hmm. my sister and I, when that show first started and then they introduced her sister and brother, Santa Monica and Johan, we were like, oh, we're here. We've made it. We're on network TV. My sister is 100% Beau, like absolutely driven, you know, the eldest daughter, completely motivated, the most successful. My brother is absolutely Johan, creative, kind of about the world, you know, kind of got this like, very unique perspective. Like Prince gave him permission to be weird, so he leaned into it, right? Yeah, and then you have it. Santa Monica, who's like, I'm pretty, I'm the youngest, I'm gonna marry rich. I did not marry rich, but there was a lot about Santa Monica where everyone in the family was like, okay, so the three of us finally have representation on TV. And then, you know, that show ended, I think they had six seasons also, maybe. I'm trying to recall when it did end. But then then that goes away on network television. We still sort of have Insecure. Meanwhile, you have BET and Oprah's network producing content, of course. But again, those are cable channels. And I think OWN is a premium channel. I think you have to pay extra for it.
Yeah, I don't get Oprah shows.
Yeah. So there's still this level of like limited access to Black television. And what's great about the 2021 forward is that they are staffing Black writers. You know, it is a diverse writers' room. They are hiring Black directors to be a part of the shows, but it's still in very small numbers that we're seeing on major network television. Streaming has definitely changed the game, though. Like,
yeah,
streaming has not even to the playing field, but has definitely made it where there's more options.
Yeah. And even, you know, I'm thinking about some of these shows that you named, some of them which do really rely heavily on the strong Black woman stereotype, mm-hmm. like Scandal. And you didn't mention How to Get Away with Murder.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about How to Get Away with Murder. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. I didn't get into that show because I don't like things that are about murder.
Oh, fun fact about Julia, which should be normal, but I actually think that's pretty weird.
I can't hang. I cannot. I'm so sensitive now. Like, I'm trying to get through Mr. and Mrs. Smith with Donald Glover. I almost called him Charles Gambino. And I was like, oh, he's a genius. Everything. I loved Atlanta. I love his music. Like, this is going to be great. I get through the first. I was like, if one more person gets shot or something blows up, I'm going to curl up in a ball. And then it did. And so I had to turn on, you know, something light and fluffy. Like, I think I put on Made in Manhattan to make myself feel better because I was like, I can't with the violence.
And it's kind of like, it's violent light. Like, it's violent, but mm-hmm. it's not emotionful violence. It's not
It's like we're like assassins.
Random people are dying. Yeah. You know, like, it's not, like, involved. It's not like right. you know, you're watching, I don't know, Denzel and The Equalizer or something.
Oh my gosh, The Equalizer ruined me. I think that's when it started. I was like, I don't think I can do violence anymore. That was heavy. That was a lot. Like, I need to go find something light to watch. Where's A Different World? Like, I can't do this. Like, give me Gilmore Girls. Like,
yeah.
Let me, like, sink into some serious white privilege to forget about pain. Like,
I will say there's some media that I cannot watch, and it's because of the show, a white show, The Magicians. Have you seen Magicians? It's not great. I mean, well, my husband loved it, but they have a sexual assault scene. Oh, and so I found myself really, really triggered. I still have nightmares about that scene. And even though, you know, these types of scenes are not uncommon in our media. But for whatever reason, well, I know the reason. I'm not going to go into it because who wants to go there? But so now I can't, I forward through anything having to do with sexual assault. I try not to watch that stuff because that's like, so I get it to that extent. But I love action movies. So I watch a lot of murder. Yeah.
Yeah. You're like Keanu, John Wick.
Yes.
It's a very popular franchise.
I love it all. Reacher. But okay, we're moving up. None of these shows.
This is not on topic at all. Yeah, let's continue.
So we're moving far away. Go ahead. You were going to say something.
Well, I was going to say, and then Harlem comes to us in 2021 on Amazon Prime. And it literally, I watched the first season and I was like, if this had come before Sex and the City, I probably would have been a much healthier 20s. Like, my 20s would have been so much healthier for me. Because it is, they're such a great, tight-knit friend group that doesn't center on one of the characters. It's on all of the characters. This is what I wish we saw more of from stories about New York, right? Like, you have each character, they're all very different from each other, but yet they have this really great bond rooted in community and love. And and it's interesting because I'm going to draw a line here, I promise. We did an episode about the Cheetah Girls too, and my guest after the fact emailed me and she's like, you know what else is also great about the Cheetah Girls franchise is that when it comes to brown and Black communities, we are rooted in community. There isn't really individualism. And so our shows, when they reflect that, it feels really good to see it because it is a reminder that we are community-focused people. And I was like, 100%, and that's probably why I loved Harlem so much, because they are their own community and they stand by each other and they love each other and they show up for each other. And they're so different. Like, each character is so different from each other. And it's nice because what we did see a lot of in the 90s as well, outside of having Black content, was also television shows that were like, you need to have an Asian friend, you need to have a Black friend, you need to have a Hispanic friend, you need to have a white friend. And then there, everyone's covered, but they're just tropes minus the white person. The white person is not a trope, but all the other ones are tropes or caricatures of that culture. And so here's Harlem and ties a mask lesbian, and Quinn is a pretty rich princess, and Camille is, you know, she's a anthropologist, she's a PhD, she's a academic, and then there's
what's her name? My God. Angie,
thank you. I was like, oh my God, I love Angie. Like, how am I forgetting her? I love her. I forget her. And then here's Angie, who's kind of messy and theatrical. Like, she loves theater. She loves performing. And they're all kind of messy in their own ways. But Angie is like the one where you're like, oh girl, you messy. Like, you are the friend that is the wild card. But also, I know you're going to show up when I need you. Mm-hmm. And not even when I just need you. You're going to show up. Mm-hmm. And it was so beautiful. And again, it's on a streaming service. And same with Insecure. Insecure gave us, you know, these characters who were sort of – like, Issa's character is so awkward. And just trying so hard, and is like, how do I work in this world? And her friend group, again, is also very different and varied. And it's just so refreshing, because it's a reminder that we're not all the same. Like, everyone right. says the Black community is not a monolith, but then the majority of the art we get is a reinforcement that maybe we are.
Right.
But we're not.
Right. And when we see ourselves represented that way, you know, it's easy to fall into, well, then I'm not Black enough because I'm not like that. So yep. What I also loved about Harlem, not just the friend group, but all of the characters are very, I mean, there's the aunt, the ex-boyfriend's auntie that is straight tripping. There yes. is what's her face's current boyfriend, who's a male stripper, who mm-hmm. is
Angie's boyfriend, or not yeah. Angie's boyfriend, but Quinn's boyfriend, and he's yeah. a yeah.
We're talking about Angie's boyfriend and how she spent a whole episode trying to re-Uber this person just to find out he lives in his car. And
messy, loved it. I was like, that is, we all have a friend who's going to be like, where is that D? I need to find it, right? Like, it's just so great. And like, with Quinn's conflict about like, I can't date somebody who's a stripper. Are you kidding? But their connection and their bond is so good. Mm-hmm. And you're just like, this is such a great, like me, the hopeless romantic. I'm like, I want love like that. Oh my God.
Let me go find a male stripper. Yeah. He could dance to his body. Mm. But anyways, no objectifying on this show. So so I want to talk now about the strong Black women, because this particular episode of Harlem that caused me to kind of change this conversation, but not really. We were already going to talk about this to some extent, is the way that we see in the episode all four of these women just completely break down at the same time, at the end of the episode. And it's a recognition of, like, I need softness. I need vulnerability. I need to let this out. Like, I can't keep holding this all together. And this is a safe space for me to do this. And, you know, the thing I like about Harlem, too, is there's always like a little history lesson at the beginning from the perspective of what's her name?
Megan. Camille.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so she starts the episode talking about the strong Black women and just what that can look like. And so I do want to say, I want to ask you, Julia, what has been your interpretation of the strong Black woman in your life, like the stereotype in your life?
Being a single parent, it has been very much that you're not allowed to have emotion and you're not allowed to show any weakness. And Whitney, I experience big emotions. That is part of my DNA. I don't know if it's because I'm a Pisces or, yeah, right? Like, I don't know. It's like, I don't know what it is. I'm the youngest. I'm a Pisces. I'm creative. I'm an art. It's happening. Like, and I spent many years running from being a person who accepted the fact that I could have big emotions and I needed to experience them and work through them versus shoving them in a closet. Nothing good comes from being shoved in a closet. Ever for anybody. And so when I when we started having shows like Insecure and Harlem and even 20s on BET and Run the World, I started unpacking, well, what is it that I hate about that trope? What is it that I hate about being told, you're so strong, I'm so impressed with how you can hold it all together. Meanwhile, my bank account is in the red and I don't feel like I can talk to anybody about it because they're just going to placate me and be like, well, you're strong, you can do it. Mm-hmm. You'll figure it out. No, I don't currently in the moment want to figure it out. I want to have a meltdown. Mm-hmm. Let me have a meltdown, please.
Right. And also, like, I want somebody to come pay these bills for me. Like, I don't want to be this. Mm-hmm. I want to be like, can I just go back to being a child? Like, can I go back to having my parents pay my bills and my parents Amen. Buy my mm-hmm. clothes? And like, can somebody else take these kids? Like, can I just go back? Can we rewind? Like, I don't even want to be this strong Black woman.
Yeah. Please, let's rewind. Oh my gosh. Yes. And I think with is because that episode aired in 2021. And so mm-hmm. we know 2020 was a big year for everything. And in 2021, watching that episode, and what I love about Harlem and Camille being an anthropologist is that she's bringing us that historical context in a very digestible academic way for us to do a self-reflection. It doesn't feel like I'm being fed a lesson. It feels like, no one's ever said mm-hmm. So then you do this sort of internal reflection. And that's when I started thinking, I'm going to start leaning into and accepting the fact that I have big emotions. I'm going to politely smile when someone says that, oh, you're so strong. And then also remind them that I wouldn't say no to a wealthy, attractive man who wanted to marry me and pay all my bills. I mean, half a joke, but half real, right?
Give me like, what do you call them? What do I call my husband sometimes? Moneybags Lee. I want a sugar daddy. Give me a sugar daddy. Anytime my husband gets a bonus, Moneybags Lee.
Yes. And also, like, don't judge me because I enjoy going to get a pedicure every other month. Like, there's nothing wrong with that sort of level of pampering and softness. We are allowed that. I'm allowed that. And sometimes that's what I need to help me through my big emotions, mm-hmm. you know, and I feel like if I hadn't been a mom so young, I would have experienced the strong trope differently. Because then there's also that layer of, you know, oh, well, the dad's not involved. You must. And then da 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 da, right? And it's like, well, his dad's white. So, like, walk away with your stereotype of Black men, please. Thank you. Like,
yeah. Well, and
P.S. Black men are involved with their kids. Stop lying to yourself. Like,
and it's even like the parenting aspect, the caregiving aspect in and of itself, and what that means. Because when I think of strong Black women, I also think emotionless. I think mm-hmm. BS, but I think independent.
Cold, that's another one.
Cold, yep. Independent and nurturer. And yeah. those two things, particularly for those of us who are caregivers, whether it's children, whether it's parents, whether it's loved ones, getting stuck in this idea of I'm not successful as right. whoever, myself, mm-hmm. I'm just not successful. Mm-hmm. Successful if I am not both nurturing and independent of everybody else, like nurturing of everybody, but independent of help and not taking your bullshit. Mm-hmm. It's like if I need help, then I'm internalizing that I'm not strong. And as someone growing up in a world of strong Black women, it's kind of like, well, if I'm not strong, then what am I? Mm-hmm. Like, am I going to be the quote welfare queen? Like, what other stereotype am I going to fall into if mm-hmm. I'm not being the strong Black woman? Because the strong Black women and like Black excellence are like mm-hmm. the gold standard stereotype for Black women.
Yeah, and I just need us to normalize mediocrity and Blackness too, because some of us have mental health that make it harder to achieve excellence. But not only that,
we're just human. Like, excellence is bullshit. Like, you know, it's what is excellence?
Exactly. And, you know, when you were talking, it struck me too, like, one of the things I've been grappling with this week, actually, is I've always been an independent person. My siblings are so much younger than I am, or excuse me, older. I can't believe I said younger. That is not true. These people are pushing 50. I'm not even 40 yet, okay? Like, and so I've had this experience of being an only child, but also the youngest child. So very content being at home, playing in my room, doing my own thing, because there wasn't a counterpart. There wasn't really a peer age-wise. I did have a cousin close in age, but it was, you know, summers. We spent summers together and, you know, throughout the year a little bit here and there, holidays, what have you, but not in the same way that you grow up with a sibling who's close in age. And this week I had this revelation of, oh, I'm completely fine being independent. I'm accepting it now, because when I do a reflection of the last several decades, that's always been a part of my DNA. Mm-hmm. It's misinterpreted by other people, and I'm fine being okay. I'm fine being alone until I'm not, and that's when I go and seek comfort from friends or loved ones or what have you. But it's really interesting how the assumption is I'm independent because of the tropes that we see in media.
Yeah. I want to, I was doing, of course, some research before this conversation and ran across a few things that I wanted to mention. And one is the idea of the strong Black woman really starting in childhood, in mm-hmm. our childhood as Black girls. And so I'm familiar with this survey, this study that was done by Georgetown called Girlhood Interrupted, The Erasure of Black Girls' Childhood. I'm familiar with it because in my legal practice, some of my colleagues were representing Black girls in the education system who were being overly punished, unfairly penalized, and experiencing the disproportionate amount of punishment compared to their white girl mm-hmm. counterparts. So I want to read some of these statistics, because what they did was they surveyed adults from every kind of background around what they thought of Black girls. And these are some of their findings. And the age started at age five. So Black girls mm-hmm. from age five and up, which my son is six. So, and he has a Black girl bully right now, but mm-hmm. later. So Black girls seem older than white girls of the same age. Black girls need less nurturing than white girls. Black girls need less protection than white girls. Black girls need to be supported less than white girls. Black girls need to be comforted less than white girls. Black girls are more independent than white girls. Black girls know more about adult topics than white girls. And Black girls know more about sex than white girls. And it's a trip, y'all. Because we're not even talking about white adults. We're talking right. about all of us adults mm-hmm. on a generalized level perceive Black girls as older than they are. I think the word was adultification. Mm-hmm. of these Black girls. And some of these, you know, when we're talking about Harlem, we're talking about the strong Black woman. Like, what Julie and I did not mention is that this scene where all these people are breaking down crying is happening in the hospital after mm-hmm. Ty, one of the characters, has been ignoring this pain, this physical pain that she's been having for some time, passes out twice, goes to a doctor one time and is basically dismissed. Mm-hmm. Goes to the doctor the second time and needs to have emergency surgery on an ovarian cyst that had ruptured. And so this all, it makes sense how we are as Black women living this stereotype, starting so young as age five, because mm-hmm. this is what people think of us. Therefore, this is who we wind up having to show up as, because that's how we're being treated. We are being treated as if we're stronger. So like, if we ain't gonna get all the support, then like, I guess I need to rise to the, like I need to grow up quicker. I wonder what your thoughts are on that.
Yeah, it's interesting in that scene too, because the first doctor that Ty experiences, he complete, like she's talking about having had an 11-day cycle and how that's unusual for her, and she's dismissed for it. And then, you know, Quinn's like, can we get her some medication for the pain? And the doctor's like, oh, so you're pill seeking, immediately assumes that she's, you know, having some sort of withdrawal or whatever. She's seeking drugs, right? Like she's drug seeking. And then it is, and I think it's important to note that it is a white male doctor who is attending to her in this time of emergency. And then you have later in the episode, this scene with Angie, and they're doing Get Out the Musical. And it's hilarious. But the lead character who's playing Ali Williams's character from the movie is doing her number, and she's singing and she's dancing, and then she trips on something and then proceeds to refer to everything about the production as ghetto. And Angie's like, so we're just going to ignore the fact that she's basically like saying like racially charged stuff. Like, and Angie confronts her and doesn't even say, ma'am, you were racist, just says like, hey, it's not actually cool for you to be using the term ghetto like that. And then the white girl is like, are you calling me racist? And then runs off and cries. And then Angie's storyline is basically like, Angie, you're in the wrong. You need to go and apologize. And she's even being placated, like she's even being talked to by other Black characters about how this wasn't okay. She needs to make whatever this little girl's, you know, name is feel better. The production can't go on until she apologizes. And then we fast forward again to when Ty's back in the hospital because she's passed out the second time in the airport, like you mentioned. But this time we have a Black nurse with her, telling her and explaining to her what has happened and what she can expect next. And the way she is caring and empathetic towards this person is night and day compared to what all of the other scenarios in the episode have happened. And it's so upsetting because there is that, with that adultification, we're forgetting that we're not allowing children to be children. Children are children. If there is adultification of Black children, it is not our fault. It is the system that was designed to oppress us fault. And so when we, the other thing that it reminded me of when I was rewatching it was there's a scene in Survival of the Thickest where Mavis's character, which is a show by Michelle Buteau that is loosely based on her memoir. So Mavis is in the hospital for whatever reason, and her best friend Marley, this white doctor walks in, man, and her best friend Marley is like, we're not doing this. I am finding us a Black doctor. And then proceeds to go through the entire hospital looking for a female Black doctor, finds one, and short of holding her collar, walks her into Mavis's room to like do proper treatment. Because that's what we've had to do. We've had to advocate for ourselves in that way so many times. And I think for me, my grandmother and my aunt understood that for my sister and I, and even sometimes my brother, though he, it's a whole other situation, from an early age. So they always created space for us to be little girls, indulging in our little girlness. And I think because of that, I've been able to navigate sort of that world a little differently because I was not, because I had a safe space to do it. And I'm not saying that families don't create safe spaces for their children to do it. I think because my grandparents were retired and not stressed about money, and my aunt was also like very in tuned with herself and understanding how the world saw her and treated her, they did whatever they could to protect us, which is a place of privilege that not a lot of people can say that is true for them, right? And so watching that scene was really hard because for me, it was reminded that if I didn't have a white mom and a white godmom, I would have died in childbirth with my son because they wrote down the wrong allergies. They didn't take any of my things that I was talking about seriously. And my godmom was a labor and delivery nurse. So she would come in and be like, this isn't right. We'll be right back. So I'm alive because I had two pushy white ladies in my life, right? Mm-hmm. Like, and even when I was looking for my own doctor, it was very important to me to find a Black doctor or even just a person of color because I live in a ag-focused community in California, which doesn't always equal diversity. but people would judge that. Well, why do you want a Black woman doctor? Like, why does that matter? Like, you guys, like, what do you guys have to worry about?
A whole damn lot. A whole damn lot.
And in the episode 7 of Harlem, they outline some of those things that we have to be worried about. But with the rates of, like, just not even just maternal mortality, but also other things that we have to worry about and experience. What I loved about those scenes was how these women were not afraid to speak up and be vocal. And again, that's another place of privilege that they can step in, right? Like, not every community, the hospital you are in, can you do that and actually get a result or have action, you know, taken. But it's giving us language and kind of a roadmap to understand how you can say things that you need an advocate in there with you. You know, these, and that's what's so great about the show is that it's saying, hey, here's Black existence. Not everything we're going to show you on this TV show is specifically about the racial prejudices that one experiences every day. But when they step out of their world, their creation, and go into the real world, this is what it's like, and it ain't easy.
Yeah, I loved the two hospital scenes. I loved Quinn because she was badass.
I love Quinn so much.
And she's one of the main people. So in the first hospital scene, she's the only other person in the room. Mm-hmm. So she is doing a lot of the advocating for Ty, who Ty is also advocating for herself. And then in the second hospital scene, Quinn is with others and they're all kind of advocating. And I found myself wondering whether they were concerned about looking like angry Black women. And the sadness of, for me, that's a sad thought for me to have, because it's the gaslighting and it's the stereotype threat. So stereotype threat is this like self-fulfilling prophecy where we are so concerned that our behavior is going to conform to a stereotype that we're kind of preoccupied by the conflict that it creates for us to act or do, you know, do the thing. And so in this case, it's the angry Black woman stereotype. And my concern of, okay, if they're getting too loud, if they're getting too, talking too fast, if they're using too much slang or cuss words, then the doctors are going to dismiss them altogether.
Right, right.
Because they're going to be perceived as an angry Black woman who is dismissed as being basically too much and unjustifiably. So I loved that the portrayal of this scene did not care about the angry Black woman. Mm-hmm. Like, there was no holding back from anybody in those rooms who were advocating for Ty's medical care. They were loud, they were cussing, they were concerned, there were tears, there was like, what the fucks, I'm not still seeking, and in my own experience, similar to you, I've had experiences of needing to plead for pain medication after childbirth, and for feeling like, from a Black nurse, like I was communicating with a Black nurse, for feeling, what she told me was, because I had had a vaginal delivery and everybody else on the floor had had a C-section, I actually did not need narcotics.
Whoa! I mean, and childbirth is painful regardless if it's vaginal or cesarean. I'm sorry. Like, no.
Look.
Sorry. No, I had a reaction. I apologize.
Nope. No problem. Because that's how I'm feeling on the inside. But I'm also feeling this like, well, maybe it doesn't hurt that bad.
Right. Maybe it's sort of causing doubt.
Yeah. Maybe my pain isn't a 10. Maybe my pain is a 7. And, you know, she's telling me she's only going to give me the narcotics and my pain is a 10. And so it's all of these things that are coming up when we're dealing with this strong Black woman stereotype. And the one other quote that I want to give before we move on to the angry Black woman is this. It's relating to women, Black women at work. And it's from the Lean In Women in the Workplace survey where they spoke to tons of Black, or not just Black women, tons of people.
Women.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because they do, I think it's like 9 or 10 years running now, they do a survey about women in the workplace. So it says, even as they navigate incredibly difficult experience, Black women are pushing their companies to do better. Black women are more likely than any other group of employees, including men of color and women of other races and ethnicities, to spend a substantial amount of time on DEI, so diversity, equity, inclusion, work that falls outside of their formal job responsibilities. They are more likely to speak out against bias and discrimination at work and more likely to experience retaliation for doing so. And they are more likely than any other group of employees to step up as mentors and sponsors to other women of color.
Mm-hmm.
Like that is the experience. That is our experience. And it's like, this for me is strong Black women, but it's kind of like by nature of our Blackness.
Yeah. What's interesting too about the two differences between the scenes when we first see Ty in the hospital to the second one, when we see Ty, I think they is the pronoun that Ty uses.
Shit.
I'm remembering it now. So we're both there, is that the second doctor seems to be a little bit more understanding. And I don't know if that's because, you know, he's also, maybe he's Jewish, and so he understands a little bit of that marginalizedness, or, you know, the nurse we saw Ty with earlier was Black, so maybe he's doing the work. I don't know what it is, but even though he's still sort of offering these things that are like, whoa, 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 sir, he's more receptive to the feedback than the first doctor was. And that to me was great to see, even though it's like, don't just assume that somebody is in the hospital who, you know, has female anatomy and is all these things. It's still just, I think that contrast is so important too.
Mm-hmm.
And it's subtle. It's very, very, very subtle. And I don't think I noticed it the first time I watched the episode. I noticed it this time.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing that you said that I wanted to bring up too is that the pain threshold for everybody is different. And so it is completely unfair to assume that all Black women can tolerate pain in the same way, because that is unequivocally untrue. And then the DEI thing that you read, I worked for a company. DEI is not my area of expertise unless you're talking about pop culture. I will dissect it, race and gender, all day, every day, right? Like, we will get down and dirty in that gutter, okay? But the corporate company I worked for was like, hey, we just got a contract with this Native American company, and they asked about our DEI. You want to be a part of that? And I was like, I am not in a position to be able to do that in a corporate setting. You want to talk about pop culture? Cool. That is not my area of expertise. I am a communications professional. I mean, I guess you could say I could have done it because I'm a communications professional. We had to talk to all communities, not just the major dominant culture. But it was this moment of like, did you not read my resume and what my area of expertise is? Like, what?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. And so many of us are, we just kind of fall into it, either because we're pushed into it by the people around us who see mm-hmm. that we care about being treated better. like just for ourselves, like I want to be treated better. And so I've advocated for myself. And now all of a sudden I'm the DEI person for everybody, you know, or maybe we actually do, you know, have that passion, but this work absolutely disproportionately falls on us in the workplace. And, you know, this is an opportunity for those wanting to act in solidarity. Like this is a space for you to step up and be in solidarity. Hey friends, so this episode was so good. Julie and I had such a good time talking to each other that we spoke for another 35 minutes about the angry Black woman stereotype. I've decided to split the episode into two parts, and so the next part will be available soon. Make sure that you subscribed on wherever you're listening to this podcast so that you can get a notification about when the episode becomes available. The next episode features Julia again, and we're going to be talking about the angry Black woman stereotype. You can find Julia on Instagram at @TheJuliaWashington, and you can also check out her podcasts, Jelly Pop Book Club and Pop Culture Makes Me Jealous. If you want more from me, Whitney, go to my website, www.impostrixpodcast.com. All my information is there. All right, y'all. Until next time, be validated. Thanks so much for joining me for this conversation. I hope that you got as much out of it as I did. Feel free to continue the conversation with us over on Facebook at the Impostrix Podcast Validating Space. We welcome all, and it's a space for us to validate each other as we work through work, race, and imposter syndrome. You can find out more about me or about the podcast at www.impostrixpodcast.com. And don't forget to follow me on Instagram at @ImpostrixPodcast. Until next time, be validated.